TEDx.
So one of the worst aspects of my undergraduate in electrical engineering was that there weren't a lot of women. So I was actually very socially awkward. I didn't know how to interact or talk with a lot of girls. So when I went to graduate school for bioengineering at UCSD, there was this girl that I had a huge crush on. And luckily, I had a chance to actually be in a party with her. And so when I met her at this party, you know, I managed to get her alone. I was having a conversation. I was hoping everything was going well. You know, I figured I was doing good. So finally, I gathered up my courage, and I asked her out on a date. And she responded with, sure, and my heart soared. And then she hit the kicker. When they find a cure for cancer, walked away. So as I sat there dejected, I was actually working on cancer at the time. So I started thinking of, well, you know, why is it so difficult to actually work on this and find a cure for cancer? Why is it, why isn't there an easier way to do this? So let's talk about cancer for a little bit and what it entails and what the different aspects are. Well, cancer is basically cells gone wild. All it is a cell that gets a mutation and it divides uncontrollably. It doesn't matter where it happens in your body. Caused a quarter of all deaths worldwide, and it costs about $100 billion in direct costs in America alone, and about twice as much of that in indirect costs due to lost productivity and time and so on and so forth. And the main reason that this is the case is that if you look at the lifespan of a tumor going from stage zero all the way up to stage four, at about at stage four being that it spreads everywhere, stage zero it's just started, at about stage two to stage three is where actually most of the cancers are currently detected. Usually, you start bleeding profusely and you're not sure why. You have unexplained pains or headaches, or you have other symptoms that suddenly show up. And so you go to the doctor, and then the doctor actually diagnoses you. We actually need to detect cancer here, stage zero to stage one. And the reason why is because if you were to look at a five-year survival rate, it's a huge difference. If you look at the four major cancers that affect in America right now, you have lung, prostate, colorectal, and breast. The blue in this graph represents early stage or localized, and the red in this graph represents late stage or spread. You can look at the survival rate, and it's about anywhere between 4 to 15 times as much for the four major cancers, and this is true for every single cancer. How many times have you guys heard, he has cancer, but luckily they caught it early? So if you look at the survival rate as well, the other thing that stands out is if you find it early enough, most of these cancers are close to 100% cure rates. So you don't actually need necessarily a magic pill, you just need to find it early. Conversely, if you look at the five-year mortality rate of these same cancers, you can see that the in the blue again is the incidence now, how many people get it, and then the red is the mortality, how many people die from it. For lung cancer, you have about 75% death. But for the other three cancers, colorectal, breast, and prostate, you have much lower levels. Still unacceptable, but much lower levels. And part of the reason why is because for colorectal cancer, you have colonoscopies. For breast cancer, you have mammograms. And for prostate cancer, you have PSA. So you can actually find it earlier and actually treat it. But almost every other cancer, you have nothing. And part of the reason why is because we have a lot of ineffective and costly detection methods. So to give you an example, I'm going to give you a quick analogy as to why this is the case right now. So there's a drunk guy looking for his keys under a lamppost, and a police officer walks by. And then he has a conversation with the drunk guy, and he says, well, what are you doing here? And the drunk guy says, I'm looking for my keys. So the police officer gets down on his hands and knees and searches under the spotlight as well. After a few minutes, he gives up, he gets up, and he goes, I can't find your keys. Are you sure you lost them here? And the drunk guy goes, no, I lost them over there. So the police officer says, well, why are you searching over here? Well, because here's where the light is. I can't see over there. In the same way, right now, the reason we have these ineffective detection methods is because that's where our technology is. We identify what we can see. So if we can't see it, we don't actually bother identifying it. So we're looking somewhere. We need to look everywhere. And that's the key. In other words, you want to take this hidden key, you want to actually reveal it. So what is this hidden key, and how can we actually identify it? Well, here's a quote by Dr. Leland H. Hartwell, who has the Nobel Prize in Medicine and Physiology. He says, the biggest payoff in cancer would be the discovery of biomarkers measured in blood that reflect early stage cancer. So you need two things to actually be able to detect these cancers. One is a blood-based biomarker that's indicative of every single cancer and has to rely on what the definition of cancer is. The other one is a technology to isolate and detect this biomarker to actually have an effect. So to explain where this biomarker is coming from, I'm going to take you back again to another analogy to give you an idea of how it works. So imagine a single cell is like a brick, and basically you are going to be forming a house out of it. You have a blueprint, it's really easy. Brick by brick, your cells actually build into an organ, and you get a nice, beautiful house. Well, cancer is basically a disease of mutation. It's the equivalent of throwing bricks as fast as possible into a pile and to see what you get. You get a giant mountain. But at the same time, the same effects occur. You get a lot of shattered bricks, you get brick dust, debris flying everywhere. So in the same way, if you take these cells and they proliferate rapidly, which is what the definition of cancer is, a lot of the cells die. They release what's known as cell-free DNA, which is their innards outwards, because they explode. And if you can isolate that DNA from your bloodstream, and using current sequencing as well as other technologies that exist, you can actually identify whether or not you have cancer, where that cancer is located, what type of treatment to give, and so on and so forth. So the next thing you need is a technology to actually be able to isolate this. And this is what I was working on. So you can use AC electric field microarrays, and that's actually what you're looking at right now, is a simulation of what it actually looks like. So the blue here is a microelectrode array, and the yellow circles are microelectrodes, about 80 microns in diameter. So they're about the width of a human hair. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a quick video of how this actually works. So you take your blood, which is broken down into red blood cells, white blood cells, DNA, and a bunch of other things, but we're keeping it simple here. You turn on electric field, so all you're going to do is just push a button. Your cells and everything that you don't want will move away from the electrodes. And at the same time that this is occurring, the high molecular weight DNA, which you're about to see in green, moves onto the electrodes. That's it. It's just as simple as that. Just push a button and walk away. Then you do a simple fluidic wash. You wash away all your cells and the stuff you don't want, and there's your DNA. And you can actually identify with that DNA whether you have a problem or not, and use secondary analysis. So here's what it actually looks like. It takes a single drop of blood and about 15 minutes. You put it in, you turn the electric field on, you just let it run through. For a normal patient, this is exactly what you see. This is normal pulled serum, but it works the same way for plasma, blood, whatever you want to actually use. This is what a cancer patient looks like. You can actually see these bright green rings that actually show up of the cell-free DNA that's in your bloodstream. And here's what it looks like if you do it over a whole bunch of different cancers. So on the top left, you can actually see a normal sample. And then on the others, you can see breast cancer, colorectal cancer, pancreatic cancers, as well as prostate cancer. In each and every one of these, you see a whole bunch of this DNA show up that doesn't actually exist in the normal samples. So by isolating this DNA, you can actually now start identifying early stage whether or not somebody has something, as well as use it with secondary markers to go forward. So early detection through a blood-based biomarker is this hidden key to actually curing cancer. So if you combine this with the new technologies that are coming out, which is targeted therapy, sequencing that's getting faster and cheaper every day, you will actually be able to identify whether or not a person has cancer, where that cancer is located, and how to go forward. And within the next 15 years, I hope and I believe that there will be a plausible path forward towards an actual cure for cancer, for every kind of cancer. And I just want to say, when that day comes, and you know who you are out there, I expect a phone call. Thank you.